Well, welcome everyone. I'm Malcolm Bell. I'm your host for another in our series from our CV departments here in Rochester of interviews with the experts. Thank you to all you listeners and viewers for joining me once again. Today we have a very interesting topic of dyspnea after pulmonary embolism, and joining me today to discuss this is Dr. Stan Henkin, who's one of our vascular medicine specialists in our department and associate to professor of medicine. Stan, it's good to have you with us today.
Dr. Bell, it's a pleasure to be here and really talk about this important topic and really underrecognized topic of dyspnea after PE.
Yeah. Well, for those of you who don't know Dr. Henkin, he actually did his earlier training with us, including his vascular medicine fellowship, then went to Dartmouth Medical Center, and more recently was there as a staff cardiologist. So I just wanted to just give you another warm welcome, Stan. You've been back with us for a year. It's really good to have you back here at Mayo Clinic. So let's start off with this topic here, and maybe just tell us about your dyspnea after pulmonary embolism. I think you call this the post-PE syndrome. Tell us what it is and how commonly we may see this.
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, classically, research on pulmonary embolism in general in the last 20, 30 years has focused on acute management of pulmonary embolism. There were early trials on thrombolysis and optimal anticoagulation. There is newer trials of different device-based therapies for acute pulmonary embolism. But more recently, research has focused a bit more on chronic management of pulmonary embolism. And initially, it was just on anticoagulation. Who needs prolonged anticoagulation in one instance? Why? But when this research has been done in the past 5 years or so, it has been found that actually individuals continue to have significant symptoms after their pulmonary embolism. And I'm talking at least 3 to 6 months after pulmonary embolism, and they have noted decreased quality of life, functional impairment, shortness of breath, depression, anxiety. And so finally, researchers have started to ask, why is this happening? And so as this research has been going on, this has been termed as post-PE syndrome, which is really a heterogeneous catch-all term for different things that can cause dyspnea after pulmonary embolism. So if we define this broadly, really, post-PE syndrome is functional impairment, shortness of breath, ongoing symptoms at least 6 months after treatment of pulmonary embolism with anticoagulation. So that's really important, is that the timing piece of it. This needs to be thought of at least 6 months after optimal medical therapy, meaning anticoagulation after PE. And I think your question of how common is this is actually really important. So when we think about it, and you could say, well, if patients are treated for their pulmonary embolism, it can't be that prevalent, right? When we think about complications after pulmonary embolism, the most severe one, such as chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension, the good news is it's pretty uncommon. It's about 2 to 3% or so. But actually, the prevalence of post-PE syndrome is anywhere from 25 to 50%. So one out of two individuals with history of pulmonary embolism still reports functional impairment, dyspnea and exertion, depression, anxiety, decreased quality of life after PE. So the big question is, first, we need to be better at diagnosing it, because research really suggests it's quite common. But I think that when we ask about it, you know, we don't ask the right questions.
Stan, before we get into how you'd work a patient up for this, again, this is really fascinating. It really will resonate with a lot of our listeners and viewers and me that, you know, we recognize the great advances in the management of acute pulmonary embolism. You know, the workup is much more streamlined, efficient, better anticoagulation. And to be honest, you know, I think many of us, you know, just want to make sure that patient leaves the hospital on an appropriate anticoagulant. And you're always just worried about how long you're going to continue to that and whether they're going to have another event. But we're probably not looking out for this. I mean, is this something that we just not on the lookout for? We feel as though we've already treated the patient. And so is that why it's really sort of maybe under-recognized?
I think so. I think the big issue here is, so who is going to manage this? you know, when pulmonary embolism is treated acutely, there's been development across the country and internationally of pulmonary embolism response teams. You know, it's a multidisciplinary management of multiple different professionals that work on optimal management of patients with acute pulmonary embolism. But then who treats these patients chronically? And it's all over the place in different places. Some places it's hematology, oncology. Some places it's pulmonary medicine. Some places it's cardiology. And there is no true owning the patient in a lot of these places. When hematologists, oncologists may see the patient for pulmonary embolism and they may say, look, I'm so short of breath, they refer them to pulmonary or cardiology. You know, there is a test or two being done and they say, oh, you're fine. This is nothing. This is expected after pulmonary embolism. But it's really not, and it shouldn't be that way. So I think the first step is owning the patient. And I think at Mayo Clinic, this is why vascular medicine in collaboration with cardiology, pulmonary hypertension is such an amazing place to work, because we all own the patient. And we have optimal medical follow-up at 3 and 6 months. So I think the first step is you need to see the right person, and the right person can be the primary care physician to start. I think that's really important. And then you need to ask the right question. 3 months, how are you feeling? Are you still short of breath? What's going on with you? And so that's the first step. And then the next step is getting you to the right patient. And again, at different hospitals, it's going to be a different person, but you need to develop those pathways to get the patient to the right place.
So could you maybe then, so at that point, I mean, if the patient's doing well, you're probably not going to be doing any further workup. I mean, that'd be a good situation. But in that patient who describes your continued, fatigue, dyspnea, the symptoms that you were describing, so what would be sort of a streamlined sort of workup? And what would be the first two or three tests, the one you should be really thinking about?
Well, I think the first step is to objectively confirm that the patient is short of breath. The first question is to ask, what were you doing before your pulmonary embolism? And what are you doing now? And a lot of patients curtail their activities, not realizing that they have curtailed their activities, especially if you're older and have more comorbidities. So the first question to objectively confirm it. This can be as easy as walking in a patient in a hallway and seeing how they're feeling. And they may go, oh my gosh, I didn't realize I'm getting so short of breath. So that in an academic setting, 6-minute walk test can be really quite helpful. Because a 6-minute walk test normalizes these patients' symptoms to their age, to their gender, and looks at their symptoms before and after walking. And again, this is really helpful to objectively confirm that they're short of breath or have symptoms. Now, if you objectively confirm that they have symptoms, the next step is to get an echocardiogram and a VQ scan. Again, this should really optimally be done at about 6-month mark. So the things that you're looking for in an echocardiogram, you're looking for, is there pulmonary hypertension on an echo? Question number one. Is there right ventricular dysfunction on an echo? Question number two. And then question number three, is there anything else that's there that may be explaining their symptoms? That's simple things that happen in older population. Aortic stenosis, mitral regurgitation, LV dysfunction, diastolic dysfunction is a commonly missed one, absolutely. So that's the things looking at an echo. And then a VQ scan can be done concurrently with this as well, because a VQ scan looks at perfusion, ventilation, mismatch. And so the question is there chronic pulmonary embolism? And then combining those two tests together gives you the next step for workup. And in those instances, that's really when you should be thinking about referral to a specialist for further evaluation.
Assessment of their exercise capacity, a really thorough echocardiogram, Doppler, looking for whether they have pulmonary hypertension or all the other things. You didn't mention a CT scan, and obviously, so some of these patients may still be on anticoagulation, or they may just stop. I think a lot of people think, oh, maybe they had another pulmonary embolism. They may immediately think about a CT scan, but you didn't mention that. And is that because of at this point you were really probably looking for much smaller vessel abnormalities rather than looking for a recurrent pulmonary embolism? That's sort of the typical one that we may see in the emergency department.
Absolutely. And with the anticoagulants that we have, especially directoral anticoagulants, the risk of recurrent pulmonary embolism while on anticoagulation in general is very low. Now, it's not zero, but it's on the magnitude of 1-2%, especially in those individuals that don't have things like antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, which is when directoral anticoagulants should be used. The other issue with CT scans is that sometimes it is difficult to differentiate between acute and chronic pulmonary embolism. And this is, again, where you really need to have expertise in imaging for CT. So VQ scans are actually pretty available these days at most institutions. And I'm not a radiologist, but from what I understand, reading these is not that difficult. You're looking at difference between perfusion and ventilation mismatch. But having the expertise of differentiating between acute and chronic pulmonary embolism certainly is more difficult, looking for those webs, looking for the chronic findings, the scar. And that's hard. That can be very easy to miss. So that's why that's usually not the first step in imaging.
Well, thanks for clarifying that, because I think it's a really important point that we know there's a generation of people out there just, you know, used to ordering CT scans here for this. I mean, it's so helpful in that acute phase. Whereas they may not be sort of used to ordering many VQ lung scans. But so now you've got that patient, maybe their exercise capacity isn't great. There's some evidence of some pulmonary hypertension, you know, moderate or severe. You've got a VQ scan, you've got a perfusion, you know, ventilation mismatch. So at this point, what should we do with the patient? You talked about referral to you know, a tertiary site. Is that really the very next step, or is there other treatment one could initiate?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And, you know, Dr. Bell, I think that in the instances where there's pulmonary hypertension on echo and evidence of VQ mismatch, that actually, I think, is the easiest scenario, because that really almost sets you up for a diagnosis of chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. And it's really important to refer those patients to a pulmonary hypertension center of excellence. And the guidelines are very clear about that. And the reason for that is because the earlier you refer those patients, the better are the chronic outcomes. These patients need to be evaluated by pulmonary hypertension specialists, cardiac surgeons, interventional cardiologists for different modalities. So I think that the earlier you refer, the better. So absolutely. I think the bigger questions come up is, what happens when the echo and the VQ don't match up? So that's when we're commonly seeing maybe a little bit of RV dysfunction, mildly reduced right ventricular function, but there is evidence of VQ mismatch. So that way you can't really diagnose CTEPH, and that's where these more complicated diagnoses of chronic thromboembolic disease come in. So this is another reason why CT scans right out, you know, 6 months may not be the best tool, because we actually know that in up to a third of individuals, they may have chronic PE as a finding in their CT scan, but it's only in a few patients, in a few percent of those patients, that we think that that is clinically relevant. So this is, again, where that VQ scan becomes important, but it's discordant from your transthoracic echocardiogram. So in those individuals, again, referral to pulmonary hypertension vascular medicine specialist is really important, because the next step is, do they need an exercise right heart cath? Because they may have normal hemodynamics on their resting echocardiogram, a little bit of RV dysfunction, but you exercise those individuals with a right heart cath and their pulmonary pressures jump up and their PVR is really abnormal. So this is that exercise-induced pulmonary hypertension and chronic thromboembolic disease. And this is where management becomes really, really difficult, because we don't have a classic pathway for these patients. And this is a discussion with the patient. Do they need, would they benefit from a pulmonary endarterectomy or balloon angioplasty? And that is really a tertiary question center. So again, if you have a discrepancy, it's okay to refer. You know, this is where expertise in this becomes really, really important.
What if your echocardiogram doesn't show any significant pulmonary hypertension? I mean, we know it's a pretty good test, you know, for pulmonary hypertension, but you know, it depends on, you know, the quality of that study. Let's say your VQ scan is normal, but there's diminished exercise, you know, capacity. What do you do with those patients?
Yeah, and this is actually the majority of the patients, and this is probably the most difficult population to handle, because their testing is normal. And a lot of times we tend to say, everything's okay, things will get better, you're fine, you know, go ahead and continue anticoagulation. But the fact is, that may not be true. So really, the next best step to try to figure out what's going on is a cardiopulmonary exercise test. And again, in a lot of places, even in smaller cardiology practices these days, there is cardiopulmonary exercise testing, at least level one testing, which means that it's non-invasive testing that's available. And what you're looking for on those tests is, what is the exercise capacity? What is VO2 uptake? What else is going on? Because you may find that those patients have reduced VO2 but their heart rate response is normal, their blood pressure response is normal, everything looks great, and that may be deconditioning. And it's really important to diagnose deconditioning in these individuals. That's very common, because how you discuss that with patient is going to be very different than if it's something else going on. You can, again, take a look and see, is there a diastolic dysfunction that's going on? Maybe is there a pulmonary limitation to exercise? This is also the time that you unmask other comorbidities. This is, you know, for us as cardiologists, when I have frequently diagnosed HFpEF. This is why I've commonly diagnosed even myocardial ischemia, because patients are not used to exercising less, and now they have they're deconditioned, and they get chest pain or pressure, and they have a large anterior ischemia in their stress test. So have a, you know, the first two tests are easy. It's the next steps that really become complicated with these patients. But the most important thing that I can say is don't dismiss them. Okay. You know, don't just say it's you, you're going to get better. Really try to figure out what's going on with these patients.
And as you mentioned earlier, as it's a heterogeneous population, you may have very young patients who was a postoperative event, or they've got some clotting disorder. But then the older patients, you know, who you may unmask some other disease. So then this has been really, as I said earlier, fascinating, underrecognized. I think you've given a really very clear message in terms of how to assess these patients and when. And I'm just going to ask you if there's anything else that you wanted to emphasize before we sign off here.
Yeah, Dr. Bell, thank you for having me again. I would say that the biggest point that I want to make is develop a pathway. We've developed a pathway at Mayo Clinic where we see these patients in our thrombophilia clinic at 3 to 6 months, and we objectively evaluate that. So don't dismiss those patients, have objective measurements, and we're always here for you.
Stan, thank you so much. I think this is going to be incredibly valuable information, and I'm sure pretty much all of our listeners would have gained something from this. So thank you so much for taking the time to join us today.
Thanks, Dr. Bell.
All right. And thank you also again to our listeners and viewers.